हम लोग एक साथ ही काम करते हैं, अभी भी इंस्टीट्यूशन अलग है।
मालूम है सर, सब मालूम है। तो जी इसी को मिला के तो हाउसिंग बनाना है ना सर, इंजीनियरिंग आर्किटेक्चर और सारे चीजों को मिला के।
बेदी जी ने तो बहुत कमेंडेबल वर्क किया है रिगार्डिंग जो रूरल हाउसिंग में पहल की जो प्लान निकाली है, उसमें सीआरआई प्लेड अ वेरी एक्टिव रोल इन फैक्ट। सो दैट इज अ वन ऑफ
जी
इट्स काइंड डॉक्यूमेंट आई थिंक,
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर, थैंक यू, थैंक
बहुत ही बढ़िया डॉक्यूमेंट है रूरल हाउसिंग पे पहल।
यू सर,
अब देखिएगा दो वॉल्यूम है उसके, इट्स अ वंडरफुल डॉक्यूमेंट।
ओके सर, थैंक
क्योंकि
यू
इसके बारे में बताना
सर।
इनको, बताओगे ना आज?
आज उसमें नहीं है सर, आज तो मैं रूरल हिल के बारे में थोड़ा बात करा
अच्छा
सर,
हिल के बारे में बात।
हिल हाउसिंग के बारे में।
अच्छा,
सर नेगी साहब जो है ना बहुत आहिस्ता आहिस्ता चीजें निकालते हैं।
हाँ नहीं इनका ही शायद इनका ही रिलीज भी प्राइम मिनिस्टर ने किया था ना शायद, नेगी जी?
जी
हाँ
सर, हाँ प्राइम मिनिस्टर ने किया था सर, हाँ
प्राइम
सर,
मिनिस्टर ने ये किया था। यस यस आई थिंक
हाँ
योर
नेक्स्ट
सर
उसकी डिटेल
फॉरवर्ड।
भेज दी आपने, इंस्टीट्यूट के लिए खरीद लेते हैं उसको।
हाँ पहल रूरल डेवलपमेंट में मिल रही है, आप ले सकते हैं और डाउनलोड कर सकते हैं फ्री सॉफ्ट
वेबसाइट है
कॉपी।
सर?
हाँ सॉफ्ट कॉपी तो डाउनलोड
ओके
कर सकते हैं फ्री ऑफ कॉस्ट, अदरवाइज रूरल डेवलपमेंट को लिखना पड़ेगा, वो फ्री ऑफ
अच्छा,
डेवलपमेंट करा देते हैं, आप लिखेंगे। हाँ
हम लिख देंगे सर, लिख देंगे।
इट्स अ वेरी गुड डॉक्यूमेंट, सारी टाइपोलॉजीज इन लोगों ने उसमें डॉक्यूमेंट की है, और उसमें फिर डिजास्टर रेजिस्टेंट फीचर्स और अदर थिंग्स इंप्रूवमेंट सजेस्ट किए हैं, बहुत बढ़िया डॉक्यूमेंट।
तो सर बताइए, नेगी साहब जैसा आदमी हमें कहाँ मिलेगा?
हाँ हाँ
अरे
नहीं
नहीं
जी
सर और पूरे पूरे
नहीं
नेशन,
उस
सारे सब जगह पे, सारे रीजन्स में काम किया हुआ है इन्होंने एक्चुअली सर।
और नेगी जी आज से नहीं शायद 20-25 सालों से, हम जब नवोदय विद्यालय के टाइम से हम डिजास्टर की बात कर रहे हैं, क्यों
हाँ
नेगी जी?
जी ठीक है सर, सर सर ठीक कह रहे सर,
तो हम और लोग आए थे तो नवोदय विद्यालय चल रहा था, याद है आपको स्कूल? और
हाँ
हाँ
सर 90 में आए थे सर,
हाँ
अब
बिल्कुल
तो 30 साल हो गया सर
30 साल हो गए। हाँ 30 साल हो गए
वक्त का पता ही नहीं चलता है। हाँ
बिल्कुल
वक्त का पता नहीं चलता।
बिल्कुल।
शर्मा सर आपको कितने साल हो गए सर्विस छोड़े हुए?
10 साल हो गए
दस साल हो गए,
सर,
देखिए।
इलेवन
अच्छा
इलेवन ये आप देखिए जी, आप लोग का ऑफिस तो खुल रहा होगा अब तो कोविड का कुछ नहीं
हाँ
है?
हाँ नहीं कोविड का कुछ नहीं है सर, हम तो कोविड में भी खुल ही रहा था सर, अजय मैं हम डॉक्टर सुबीर हम तो लगे हुए थे सर
आप
तो
लोग तो
कोविड
लगे
हॉस्पिटल
हुए,
के चक्कर में। हाँ
ये आप तो बड़ा अच्छा सा लग रही है, तुम्हारा ऑफिस है या घर है? बिल्कुल घर जैसा लग रहा है
कहाँ
देखिए।
सर,
अच्छा
मेरा ऑफिस है सर, हमारा स्टूडियो है।
स्टूडियो है, ओह वंडरफुल, ओहो अच्छा। आमिर साहब नेगी जी इज आल्सो हेडिंग द डिपार्टमेंट स्किल डेवलपमेंट सेंटर इन सीबीआरआई, सो ही
अच्छा
इम्पार्ट्स या ही इम्पार्ट्स स्किल ट्रेनिंग यू नो फॉर
जी
वेरियस डिसिप्लिन्स इंक्लूडिंग यू नो मैसन्स, इंक्लूडिंग आर्किटेक्ट्स, प्लानर्स, सो डिजास्टर में
नहीं
ही करें
नहीं
सब
नहीं
चीज।
सर, सर सर जो आप कह रहे थे पहले दिन भी और अभी आपने उसको रिपीट किया, अब ये बताइए ना मैं कहाँ से लाऊं ऐसे स्किल वाले लोगों को?
अरे नहीं सर ऐसा नहीं है सर, ज्यादा ही बता रहे
नहीं नहीं ज्यादा नहीं है सर, ये तो मैं आपके सामने बोल नहीं रहा हूँ, अगर मेरी अकेले में बात होगी सर से तो मैं बताऊंगा कि कितने प्रोग्रामों में आप ऑलरेडी हमें हेल्प कर चुके हैं, और हर प्रोग्राम की एक ही फीडबैक आती है कि आप छोड़ ही नहीं सकते हैं सर को।
अरे नहीं सर बिल्कुल बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, देयर इज नो डाउट, देयर इज नो डाउट।
सर बस 1-2 मिनट में और शुरू करते हैं
श्योर
एंड
हाँ
है ना, बस अभी थोड़े से पार्टिसिपेंट्स और आ जाएं, 5-10 और आ जाएं तो फिर वी विल स्टार्ट।
श्योर श्योर श्योर। तो इतना अपना वीडियो बंद कर देते हैं, हम लोग म्यूट हो जाते हैं जब आप कहोगे,
हाँ कर
खोल
सकते हैं, 2 मिनट 3 मिनट के लिए करते हैं बस।
व्हेनेवर यू से विल।
हाँ ठीक है सर, थैंक यू सर।
Aman sir, shall we start?
Please go ahead.
Shailesh sir, we are starting. I with your permission sir.
Yes, sure sir. Please.
Okay. So, namaskar and good afternoon to honorable patrons, delegates and participants joined here with us for this webinar. I, Yogita Garbha, young professional at NIDM, welcome everyone on today's webinar on disaster safe rural housing. It is jointly organized by National Institute of Disaster Management, Ministry of Home Affairs, Government of India, and Building Materials and Technology Promotion Council, BMTPC, New Delhi. This webinar topic is also in compliance with PM 10.8 Agenda number 5, 8, and 9. So when we talk about this topic, we say that over the years, the rural settlements, especially in developing countries like ours in India, are disproportionately vulnerable to natural hazards due to both biophysical and social vulnerability. So when we see any disaster occurs, most devastation seem to affect the rural areas of our country. And this is mainly due to poor quality of construction, non-engineered constructions executed by unskilled masons and lack of regulator frameworks, especially beyond the municipal boundaries. Hence, community awareness and sensitization are coupled with rigorous capacity building initiative is the need of ours. And today through our webinar, we are also focusing on that. With this, I like to welcome the convener of this program, Dr. Amir Ali Khan sir. He is currently the faculty member for Resilient Infrastructure Division at NIDM. I welcome you, sir, for the introduction and the opening remark and enlighten the participants about the importance of ensuring safety for rural areas from disasters and the other objectives. I welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Yogita. It's again a pleasure to be here. And I also take this opportunity to welcome all the dignitaries, Executive Director BMTPC, all three speakers, Sharma Saab, Chaurasia Saab, and Negi Saab, for this webinar, and all the participants for joining this program. As Yogita has already mentioned, that as far as our country is concerned, we are living in villages, and when we are talking about villages and rural areas, rural housing becomes a very important component of our lives. So safety of our housing is the paramount and most important critical aspect of our survival. So at least in those areas where hazards are coming, we have to make our housing so that it shall resist those hazards and should not convert into a disaster. So this is, in this context, we are organizing this webinar on disaster safe rural housing, considering the importance of seeing the past performance of rural housing in various type of disasters, including earthquakes, landslides, cyclones, floods, even tsunami. So the housing typology which we are using in different climatic zones for our benefit, for our comfort, to protect ourselves, are not sustaining those hazards. So this is the challenge which we are posing and which we are discussing today, that how to make our housing system safe from various hazards, including earthquake, fire. Fire is an integral part in rural areas as well. So it's not that the fire is an urban thing. Rural areas, especially in hills and in winters, it's a deadly combination. And this year, I at least 7, 8, 10 fire, big fires I can recount in Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, and Jammu and Kashmir. So this is a very common thing. So what we are going to look into, that people are aware about housing practices. They are having local materials available, but what they are missing is that tadka jo hai wo disaster safe banane wala. So we have to look into those practices where our existing practices shall be disaster safe. But certain areas like Jammu and Kashmir, Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, and northeastern India, including some Bihar parts as well, have already developed those construction practices which are disaster safe as well. So this is in this context that we have to look holistically that how we can use those traditional systems for our safety. As far as earthquake safety is concerned in rural housing, with the arrival of new material, new techniques of RCC, people are not 100% conversant with those tools and techniques. So this is another challenge which we are going to address today, that how to make our housing system safe against earthquakes as well. Not only earthquakes, but other type of hazards as well. So this is, with this background, I'm not taking much time, that I want to listen to those experts, that how we can make our rural housing. And we have requested Shailesh ji not only to collaborate with us, but to enlighten us with a keynote address for opening of this webinar. With this, I hand over the session to Yogita for a formal introduction of Shailesh Kumar ji.
Thank you, sir. I now like to introduce Dr. Shailesh Kumar Agarwal, sir. He is currently the Executive Director of Building Materials and Technology Promotion Council. Sir has been working towards the mandate of for affordable housing for all through the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana urban areas by promoting and transferring emerging housing technologies for faster and sustainable development at the grassroots level for the common people. His current areas of work are alternate building materials and construction technologies, disaster mitigation and management, skill development and capacity building, project management and consultancy, and various other fields related to that. Prior to this assignment, sir has also devoted his 20 years to provide S&T backup in the area of building science and technology, where he led many international and national R&D projects with special emphasis on earthquake engineering, structural dynamics, distress structures, etc. Sir has also established Building Dynamic Lab there in CBRI to provide the S&T backup in the area of disaster management. With this, sir, I would like to welcome you for your keynote address and kindly speak on the needs and challenges of safety in the rural housing community. Over to you. Welcome, sir. Sir, you are muted. Kindly unmute yourself.
Yeah. Thank you, Yogita, for such a nice introductory remarks. And thank you very much, Amirji, for making me part of this very significant webinar. So formally, good afternoon, everyone. I'm indeed honored to be part of this webinar on disaster safe rural housing being conducted by National Institute of Disaster Management under the overall ambit of Prime Minister's 10-point agenda on disaster risk reduction. And I think most of the participants may not be knowing, but PM gave 10 points agenda on DRR. And today, Dr. Amir will be discussing the agenda items number 5, 8, and 9. So I thought it would be prudent for me to just briefly touch upon what are these agenda items. The agenda item 5, basically Prime Minister gave this 10 points agenda during 7th Asian Ministerial Conference on Disaster Risk Reduction in the year 2016. And since then, NIDM has been taking these agendas forward so as to mainstream disaster risk reduction in the Indian subcontinent. So the agenda 5 is about leveraging technology to enhance the efficiency of disaster risk management efforts, which is very pertinent when we talk about rural housing. The agenda 8 is on building local capacities, which I think Amil was talking about, local capacities, local material, local know-how, local skills. So we need to build those local capacities and initiatives so as to enhance disaster risk reduction. And agenda 9 dwells on making use of every opportunity to learn from disasters and to achieve that there should be studies on the lessons after every disaster. So keeping these three agenda items, the Prime Minister called for reducing the risk of disasters by putting in strategic approach and integrating disaster risk reduction into all sectors, including housing and infrastructure. And since I come from the Housing Ministry, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, so I would just like to give you a glimpse of what is being done in the public sector by our ministry. Let me first tell you that India has one of the biggest housing programs being undertaken. It is one of the biggest, it is unprecedented, unthought of. This is the biggest housing program which is being undertaken in India by the present government, and this government is committed to provide housing for all by 2022. And 2022 deserves a special, it's a special year for all the Indians because that would be 75th year of our independence. So India, present government is committed to provide housing for all by 2022. Just to give you a few figures, because I am from Ministry of Urban Affairs, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, 11.2 million houses are required to be built, which is 1.12 crore. Houses are required to be built in urban areas. And when this PM, we are calling it Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban, when this mission started in the year 2015, the housing shortage was 11.2 million. And around 30 million houses are required to be built in rural areas. When the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Grami was launched in 2016. So, let me share with you, as of today, we have already sanctioned under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban 11 million houses, which is 1.1 crore houses have already been sanctioned. And out of it, 70 million houses have already been granted. Rural housing is also marching ahead steadily and will definitely achieve the target before 2022. So let me just give you what we are doing as regards disaster listing measures. While sanctioning these houses, it is often said that housing is a state subject. So what we have done is, while sanctioning these houses, every care is being taken that these are being designed, constructed using existing guidelines and codal provisions on hazard-resistant design and construction. Invariably, state government, they have to submit the detailed project reports to the Central Sanctioning and Monitoring Committee. So while approving these detailed project reports, the states are required to submit a checklist wherein clauses related with disaster resistant construction need to be complied with. Also, under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban, we are running a technology submission. This is also one of the very noble and innovative initiative taken by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. For the first time under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, under these kind of schemes, we are running a technology submission through which states and cities are being assisted in deploying disaster resistant and environment friendly technologies. Technology submission also facilitates adoption of modern, effective and green technologies and building materials for faster and quality construction of houses, including earthquake and other disaster resistant technologies and designs. Under technology submission, we are also partnering with the willing IITs, NITs, planning and architecture institutes for developing technical solutions, capacity building and handholding of states and cities. We are also, working on state and region-specific needs as regards hazard-resistant technologies and designs. As regards the Rural Housing Mission, the Ministry, Rural Development Ministry, in association with IIT Delhi, CBRI Roorkee, and UNDP, has come out with the compendium of rural housing technology, which is titled PEHEL, and it is in two volumes, which showcase building technologies that are disaster resilient, so as to handle vagaries of natural hazard specific to housing and reducing the carbon footprint and adverse environmental impact. So when we talk about disaster resilience nowadays, we need to couple it with climate change mitigation strategies and environmental impact also. So that should also be taken as part of disaster resilient technologies. At BMTPC, most of you are aware that we have come out with a Vulnerability Atlas of India. Now it's third edition we have recently published, and its digital version was released by Honorable Prime Minister in 2019. The Atlas, which used to be a bulky document, and I see a copy of Vulnerability Atlas just behind Dr. Amir Ali Khan. So this Vulnerability Atlas, we have digitized it completely, and its digital version was released by Honorable Prime Minister. And this Vulnerability Atlas can be accessed digitally through our website, which is www.bmtpc.org. And on a click of a mouse, one can get natural hazard information of a particular place, district, state of India. So just click on the map and you can get the natural hazard related information. Okay. We are also running a certificate e-course on Vulnerability Atlas of India with the School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi, to build capacities within stakeholders through self-learning about hazard and hazard-resistant construction. So through this platform, I urge all the participants and all others to publicize this e-course on Vulnerability Atlas of India and also register. And it's a very simple course through self-learning. You can pass this e-course and get a certificate. Last but not the least, I would like to mention that through the concerted efforts made by Government of India, various state governments, NIDM and NDMA, and all other organizations, including CVRI, I can say confidently that there has been a paradigm shift in disaster management from response and relief-centric approach to prevention, preparedness, and mitigation-centric approach. I will stop here and look forward for the presentation of our able speakers, especially AGG Sharmaji and Dr. Ajay Chaurasia. And AGG and Chaurasia have been my colleagues for more than two decades, and we have worked together on several aspects of disaster risk reduction. So thank you very much for the opportunity. Yogita, over to you.
Thank you, sir, for nicely elaborating on the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. I think it is very much in compliance to our topic today. And I think even we heard the feedback that they are very happy to hear that 70 million housings are already in place. So that is probably the one of the biggest achievements India is having currently. Thank you so much, sir. Amir, sir, with your permission, if you have to say something.
No, please go ahead.
Okay, sir. So with this, we will start the technical session for today. And for that, we have first speaker, architect S.K. Negi, sir. He is chief scientist, CSI, CVRI. Sir is currently the chief scientist in architecture and planning division and has more than 20 years of professional experience with his area of expertise in architecture and planning and urban and rural planning, tourism development as well. His education backgrounds includes bachelor's in architecture from Punjab University in urban and rural planning from University of Roorkee, as which is now IIT Roorkee as well. Sir has more than 26 research papers, mainly revolving around his area of expertise, and has written 5 technical reports, including guidelines using glass in buildings, industrialized building system for affordable quality housing. Sir, I welcome you for today's lecture on traditional knowledge in the rural housing sector for disaster risk reduction. Welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Yogita, for a nice introduction. Dr. Shailesh Agarwal ji, my colleague Ajay Chaurasia ji, R.C. Sharma ji, Amir Khan ji, and Yogita ji. Sabko mera namaskar, and I will start my presentation. It is visible? Yogita ji?
It is coming, sir. Now it is visible, sir.
Go ahead.
Okay. Neki, sir, just a request. There is an icon coming in the right side of the screen. Can you just minimize that?
Yeah. It is all right?
Yes, sir. Please continue.
Yeah, I'll be talking the disaster safe rural housing in hilly regions. Just give you the introduction of actually whatever rural housing actually Dr. Shailesh Agarwal told in Pahal, in that we did for the entire nation, in that Pahal document, it was covered almost 15 states, and out of 15 states we did 13 states. And today I will not cover that, but I will cover the rural housing in the hilly regions, actually what are required to be done, how to make it disaster resilient. And so this actually, if you see the census of 2011, I am talking about the Himachal Pradesh, the urban population lives in the rural total population of this urban area is approximately 10.3%, as compared to in other part in plains it is slightly different. In rural part of in the hilly states, their rural population is around 90% or 85% like this, and the total 3.65 of the geographical area, it is very less area, actually is catering the population of almost 10% population. The area wise it is very less. Why I am showing these slides, actually you can see there is a lot of concentration of population and lot of pressure on the urban areas. because people are migrating for better infrastructure and so many things. And the all the hill states, like whether you talk about Uttarakhand and Himachal, they come under zone 4 and zone 5. Now actually, like human settlements in hill, actually development in hills, hill settlements, especially the towns and its surrounding area, is a challenging task, as the hill and mountain regions are highly sensitive, and we all know it's a very fragile to ecosystem, and we have a lot of scenic beauties and as a visual resource. But development in hill has a, actually whatever development we have to do in hills, we have to see whether we are not affecting the environment, or environment should not affect the whatever development we should be doing in the hills. The development issue becomes more complicated when we are doing the large projects in hills, whether it is a capital complex or colleges or any institutionals are coming day by day. Due to this very high population density, these hill settlements are highly vulnerable, and because of this highly the pressure, there can be a lot of damages, like we are deforestation, rapid change in this land use and vegetable resource, and so many things. Because of this, actually you can see, like because we are doing so unsystematic and infrastructure development, you can see lot of landslide, erosion, flooding, and forest fire, and so many problems. Even like Amirji was saying, there are almost more than 10 fires in the recent past in Himachal and this JNK and Uttarakhand. And whatever development we have to do should see that it should not affect the overall environment of the city. This is a, this photograph you can see, this down photograph. This will give you the vague idea, like it is a Sanjoli part of the Shimla. It is now a concrete jungle. Actually, nobody will like to come and visit this kind of structures. Or if any disaster will come, everything will wash away, and there will be a huge casualties and losses of human life and properties also. So whatever development we have to do, it should be scientifically, and that I will be discussing in my future slides how to do. And whatever, like the growth or the natural resources which are there, we should give prior emphasis to that, so that it should not be affected. Or whatever development we should do, it should be sustainable, or sustainable development should be done. Then what is actually sustainable development? The concept of sustainable development refers to the environmental sustainability, economic sustainability, social sustainability. To while planning achieving the sustainable development in hilly areas, we have to think the ecology of that area. That is very important. Basically, I will not go to the what are the objectives and this, and what should be the approach for sustainable development. Approach of sustainable development needs to be applied at various scales, like at regional level, sub-regional level, and local level. Until or unless we do this proper planning of the overall development, the otherwise the things will be so haphazard, and it will be unmanageable in the, and this is actually very well documented in census 1971. The entire country is divided in micro, meso, and micro regions. Now coming to the what is actually the climatic response architecture, is perhaps the oldest technical sustainable development in the hilly areas. Actually, it gives the complete how to make designs and the complete development of the hill area. The vernacular architecture addresses the climatic issues, incorporating it as a major element of design, and has developed aesthetics as per the climatic requirement. But unfortunately, the modern building designs in hilly areas have taken the clues from, they have not taken the clues from our traditional knowledge, or whatever we should say. Whatever we are constructing, it is like, even if you go to Shimla or nearby, even the towns or the village, remote areas of the Himachal or Uttarakhand, you will find the all the RCC buildings are coming, which are not required to that environment, or the environment will not accept. Now, basically, what is vernacular construction? The dwelling and structure that has respond to the topography and local climate of the region, built by using available resources, emerge out of hard necessity of the place, and using very less professional expertise, or so many things are there. This is the example of I am showing. This is a top photograph. This photograph is basically the Hidimba temple in Manali. This was constructed in 1553 or some, yeah. And this is the another structure, temple structure, near Kullu. And this is now, you can see the changes. Now, this is the almost the traditional building construction is there, but you can see the refinement. Now, before I'll go to my detailed presentation, I'll give you the brief of the what are the problems like in hill settlements, particularly the rural areas of whether it is Uttarakhand, Himachal, or J&K, almost the or even the northeast states. The problems are almost similar. Difficult of getting stable site and orientation on hill slope is a problem. Another problem of soil erosion and landslides. Traditional construction technology is affected due to non-availability of wood. High cost involved in site and infrastructure development, and lack of basic services like road, health facilities, water supply, electric, sanitation, and so many things are there. Because of this lack of roads and this thing, the transportation of the building materials becomes very difficult. And because of this poor sanitation and no proper health facilities and education facilities are not there. And that's why the rural people are migrating to the urban areas. And inadequate planning of insufficient utilization of built-up spaces, because actually they don't have the professional guidelines or guidance of architects and engineers. So whatever they are doing based on their knowledge. Then per capita income is very low as compared to urban areas, because majority of the people are basically based on agriculture and its allied activity. The migration of educated people from rural to urban area is that because the basic infrastructure and the employment opportunities and so many things are there, they are very less in urban rural areas. And these are the some of the key factors which influences the overall built environment of the entire Himalayan region. First is the topography, then climate, and then material and resources, then user and its lifestyle. Whatever development or whatever type of typology of houses and everything is coming, it is basically depending on the basically user and its lifestyle, whether it's a joint family, single family, or so many things are there, their income and so many things. And then construction technology, culture and tradition also influence in a big way. Now, coming to the topography, if you see the entire length of Himalaya is almost 2,500 kilometers from east to west, and the average altitude is almost 4,000 meters. Above this, actually, habitation of human being or like it becomes quite difficult. Now, coming to the climate, the variation of climate conditions in Himalayan region is due to variation in altitude. And the climate varies from hot to subhumid. It is basically the lower part of the Himachal or the Uttarakhand. And then cold and tempered, it is very difficult to live in. Actually, basically the climate is affected due to the variation in altitude. Now, coming actually to the what are the main their flora and fauna? If you see almost 64% of the rural areas of whether it is in Himachal or J&K is 60% is covered in forest. And because of that, actually they are living nearby the forest, and wood is the their prime basic building material they are using for their construction. And the building materials other than wood actually is stone, slate. It is very common in almost all part of the, whether it is in Himachal or Uttarakhand, you can see the the way of construction and the way of in planes they are using in different way with the different materials based on their climatic requirement and geographical requirement also. Now coming to the typical settlement pattern, if you see the all the settlement is along the contours, and the temple or the monastery it gets very important place all around. Generally they are keeping the open space for festivals or religious gathering for the inhabitants. And this is another photograph you can see. If you see the total settlement, it looks like a perfect settlement. Actually all the settlements you can see they are all along the contour, and G+1 or G+3 development, only the important place is given to the their temple or the fort or whatever it is. And in this actually they have used most of the important buildings. You can see used of this Koti Banal architecture we called in Uttarakhand, and Kathikana in Himachal, you can find that. And this is another settlement. In this you can see the whole development is facing towards southeast, so that they can get the maximum advantage of sun. And it is perfectly like, there is not a very tall building, only you can see this is a important fort, it is at the important place. And this is the another small village of Himachal Pradesh. In this you can see the use of material, the orientation of the buildings, it looks like a perfect. Actually you won't find anything like different or this thing. Even the placement of the buildings one to other so that they can get proper light and ventilation, everything is taken care. These are some of the construction technologies which is almost used in almost whether in Uttarakhand, Himachal, almost same. This Kathikani style or Koti Banal architecture we called in Uttarakhand, and this Dajji Diwar construction, this I will discuss in detail. Then mud construction, dry stone construction, usually the 2 to 3 storied houses, high houses, and generally lower floors actually they keep for their cattle and upper floors for their residence or kitchen and etc. This is the typical way of doing the Dajji Diwar construction. Advantage of actually this is actually you can reduce the wall thickness, and this is filled with the dry stones and with mud mortar or cement. Now people have started using this wire mesh on it, and they are doing the plaster, cement plaster. But most of the houses in the rural area still you can find this sort of construction. This is mud construction. This is actually prevalent in other Leh Ladakh, in upper parts of Kinnaur and Lahul Spiti. You can see this is actually based on the indigenous material, based on the mud walls, and the wood is taken from the local. And you can see how beautifully they have done the ceiling from the interior side, you can see. And this is a multi-story construction in Leh. They have for this monasteries and all. It is possible, like whatever it is, and whatever they are doing, slight scientific intervention is required to make it a disaster resilient. This is stone wall dry construction. This is a lower part of the Himachal. Their slate is very commonly used, and since time is short, I'll not go into the details. And this is I will touch the Koti Banal or the Kathikana style of architecture. In this actually you can see the principal components in this is actually slate roof, then wooden projected balconies, and the walls. Actually in this actually walls I will discuss in later, and this wooden beams and infilled walls. And this is a typically two-storied this Koti Banal architecture. In this actually you can see the projected balconies and everything. This looks like it goes with the total environment, and they are performing very well in earthquakes. These are some of the Koti Banal architecture of temples and this thing. Only difference between the temple and this residence building is the proportions. Elements are same, material is same, only proportion difference you can find. And the main difference is like in residential building, you won't find any like plinth, and for this temple or the fort, there are the up to 1 meter to 2 to 3 meter height plinths that I will be showing. And the opening size, particularly in ground floor, it is kept slightly low so that whatever this harsh weather will not enter inside. And otherwise, in the residential, in most of the buildings which we did study, there was no foundation as compared to this temples and this main their monasteries. There they have kept proper foundation and this thing. This will give you the just idea of actually how at the corner these different beams are, wooden beams are coming. Actually, there are two beams are coming parallel to each other, and that I will discuss in later. This is how it is constructed. These wooden beams are going horizontally, and they are connected. These upper beams are connected with the wooden nails. And why wooden nails? Why not this steel nails? Actually, this wooden nails gives liberty to move during the earthquake. And these horizontal beams, they are connected with, actually this is called musabi. I will give you in the details. And another important factor is like this cornerstone. This protects the rainwater to enter in the connection joints. Every house, every important house, you will find this cornerstone detailing, and it is beautifully done. This is actually that musabi and the dry stone, and this gives again liberty because there is no mortar. These are the dry stones infilled in between, and it gives during the earthquake, it gives liberty to move, and it will not restrict these horizontal beams. And since these beams are not nailed to each other, and they are joined with these wooden nails, and gives complete liberty to move. And after the earthquake, it again comes to its original position. And this is the openings. Actually, you can see, as we generally tell people that, like, if we are constructing in zone 4 and zone 5, you should provide the plinth beam, then sill beam, then lintel beam. All the aspects they have taken consideration in the openings. No weak joints they have left. Even you can see the big openings of like ventilators, they how beautifully it is done. This is the use of internal spaces in because most of the construction, it is stone walls, and they are almost 2 feet, 60 centimeters wide. And this you can see, this is a before construction and after construction. This is beautifully done interiorly. Now coming to the social and cultural landscape, like as I said, almost 80 to 85% of the population in Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand lives in the villages, small villages. And whatever they are doing, actually it is influenced by, like, most of them are doing animal husbandry, agriculture, and it is the integral part of their living habit, or whatever infrastructure they are creating, taking consideration of this, they are doing it. Now, what are the basically parameters which is influencing? This is the social and culture. Actually, this is the first parameter. Then affordability. Based on affordability, they are doing their work. Then climate is another responsible factor which influences the entire area. Then material construction techniques, safety against the earthquake, rainfall, snow loads, everything, it is taken in consideration, whatever construction they are doing. And they are also opting for the maintenance free this thing. Architecture feature and aesthetics, it is at settlement level and unit level, it is also there. Now I'll give you some brief of the traditional construction of the upper regions of the Himachal Pradesh. Actually, you see stone, mud, timber, and slate. These are the basic principal material, and it is almost all throughout, whether you are working in lower Himachal or upper Himachal or upper Uttarakhand or lower Uttarakhand, it is the same. The material is same, but their techniques of doing or making the houses are varying from place to place. Actually, this technology is very good and earthquake resistant, but the problem with this is actually it requires very large space because wall thicknesses are almost 60 to 45 centimeters and these massive stone walls. And in lower regions, you can find this sort of structures or this sort of structures. There actually availability of wood is slightly less and they are using stone, mud and slate, but they are not connected as good as the Kathikane style construction. They are slightly dangerous in case of earthquakes. Now coming to the modern construction, actually what is right now people are doing in the rural areas of whether it is in Himachal or Uttarakhand, it is almost same. Now people are shifting towards RCC brick masonry block, RCC roof, GI sheet roof. Actually, whatever they are doing, it is very expensive as compared to the traditional construction which they are doing, because whatever material, it has to be imported from the plains. And although if it is properly designed, then they may be better than the traditional construction, but most of the houses you can find they don't have any engineers or the only local masons. They are mostly from Bihar or UP. They are engineers and architects and they are doing it. They don't know ABCD about the reinforcement at all, but they are doing the construction, which will be matlab in long run may cause a big disaster for the rural areas. Now coming to the almost the end of my presentation, the selection of appropriate site is very important when we are planning in the hilly regions. Until or unless you make assure that the site is perfect, you don't do the any construction. Design of house appropriate to socio economical and cultural pattern of the society. Actually this point I wrote is this, actually almost all the entire country you visit anywhere, if the house is not as per their social or economical requirement or culture pattern, the acceptability is very less. This is very important. Until or unless you see the what are their aspirations and what are their the culture and living pattern, acceptability is less. These are the codal provisions, like length should not be more than 3 times the width, x symmetrical. I will not, since Ajay will be covering all these aspects. Avoid large openings to provide door and windows, or it should be as per the codal provisions. The floating columns and this thing, I will not go into details. And the shapes of the building, again, I think Ajay will cover. And again, and another important part in particularly in hills, like what is missing right now in our this traditional construction is like these bands. There is no, actually if people are doing masonry construction or this thing, there is no this in case of this Kathikane style, there is no problem. In other construction, they are not providing this lintel band, this bands. Or another is like in roof band, they are providing the roof band, but some cases, majority of the cases, you will not find the gable band. And trying the whatever trusses are coming, they are not connected with the wall which is coming, that I will discuss in later. And another problem is like positioning of buildings, like what should be, how should be it done, it is given in this slide. And in this stone masonry, one second, actually we have to provide through stones and this thing, and how it should be done, this slide gives you the details. And now as I said, in the like in traditional construction, this particularly the Kathikane or Koti Basin architecture, now actually getting wood is difficult. And instead of this large wooden this beams, we can go for slightly thicker beams, or we can provide the RCC bands at different level. And another is like most of the cases you will find the roof trusses are just resting on the, there is no tying of this thing. It is important. In most of the cases you will find they have put heavy stones on top of the roof so that in case of this any wind or it will not blow away. And this is very dangerous in case of earthquake. The load of these stones will kill the people inside. And this sort of construction you will find in most of the part of this lower part of the Himalayan regions. And in this, at least we should provide this plinth beam, lintel beam, and for the different connection details. I'll not go into details because now I am coming to my concluding slide. This is actually whatever we should do in the hills, we should approach, basically scientific approach should be followed. And another important part is the optimization of spaces is not done. Actually, since in hilly and in the rural area, space is not a big problem, but it affects the overall cost of the building. And the cost of services, again, is important. They don't consider, they don't give importance to the cost, how to put the services and this thing. For this, actually, we have to make the capacity building, or we have to do some training programs to the rural areas, particularly the the pradhans, and now, because people are there, but actually they don't know how to implement it. Then cost effective construction systems, actually it is already there, and how to make it energy efficient. Orientation, built form, materials and architecture design plays a vital role. Actually, several innovative materials and construction techniques have been developed for wider application in buildings, especially for low cost mass housing programs in rural or semi urban areas. But problem is that actually nobody, even in the engineering colleges or engineers, the practicing engineers, they don't even bother to see this. If you see this, not only it will bring down your cost, it will change the overall environment. And these materials and techniques which I was talking about, they are cost effective, affordable, easily adoptable. Anybody can do. The other important factor in this is actually the training of that local labor, and whatever technologies we have to propose there, or whatever we have to do, we should do the rural skills, or the people, those who are living in the rural areas, we should train them so that whatever their economic condition will increase, and whatever government is putting the money for the rural area, it will be remain there. Otherwise, the maximum labor which we are getting is from the Bihar or UP, they are doing the construction, and whatever money government is putting there, it is coming down to the plain again in terms of materials and labor and everything. Then that's why skill development is important. And another important factor is this NVC and building bylaws of that region is important. And everybody, all the engineers and architects, those who are practicing in the hilly regions, they should at least read one time or two time this, their local building bylaws and NBC. With this, I'll conclude my presentation. Thank you very much for listening so patiently. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. So I guess we can see a few questions, but since we are a bit late, so we will take all the questions in the end. So okay, I also request the participants to be patient, and we will take the questions in the end.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your brief elaboration on the traditional practices. Now we move on to the lecture two of our webinar. And for that, I welcome Dr. Ajay Chaurasia, sir. He is Senior Principal Scientist at CBRIT. Sir is also the group leader of 3D Concrete Printing Group at CSIR CBRI. And with his PhD in structural engineering from IIT Roorkee, his area of interest encompasses MCompass, precast buildings, structural health monitoring, experimental investigation of buildings and their components, earthquake testing, designs, construction, confined masonry, repair and retrofitting of structures, seismic vulnerability assessment, post-earthquake damage assessment, numerical analysis, and historical construction. Sir has a very quite large meritorious awards and membership in his bio data, but sir, due to lack of timing, I would really like to quickly hear to your session, and I'm interested to hear you, sir, on the engineering aspects of rural housing safety. Over to you, and I welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Yoshita ma'am. Could you permit me for sharing my slides?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Is my slides visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Yes, sir.
1 minute. Now, if I am scrolling, then it is it visible? After, if at all, if I scroll?
Yes, sir. It is scrolling, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Yogita ji. Good afternoon, respected Dr. Shailesh Agrawal, sir. In fact, I take a privilege to take to call him as a bhaiya. He's elder brother to me, Dr. Amir, Dr. C. Sharma, my friend, Negi Sahab, participants. Good afternoon, and thanks for joining through this webinar. I first of all, at outset, I wish you and your family a safe stay. Since COVID-19 has not gone, it is now second wave is coming up. So please stay safe. And now I take again opportunity to say thank you to the organizer for giving me a slot to speak on the topic that is on current construction practices in rural areas of with the emphasis on Himachal Pradesh issues and way forward. This particular topic is very pertinent in today's perspective, specifically when we are talking about the Sustainable Development Goal, SDG goals, where the DRR, that is Disaster Risk Reduction, has been a very important agenda which has been taken up, and rural sector in particular. Although the Government of India has launched a very ambitious, very nice nations, among which PMAY is one of them, which has been again divided into two segments, that is urban and rural. Urban part is very nicely being handled by PMPPC MAUA under the able leadership of Dr. Agrawal. Whereas when we are concerned with the rural sector, then it is Gramin, which is being looked after by the Ministry of Rural Development. But CBRI is pioneer in bringing out building typologies in different part of the country in a document which is called PEHEL, which can also be downloaded from CSIR CBRI website. Having said this, we need to focus on not only the new buildings, but as well as the existing buildings and traditional buildings as also. Ultimately, at the end of this particular program, I hope or expect that we may also come out a smart village program kind of concept, because it is very pertinent as around 80 crores of our population resides in villages. Very minimum facility are being provided to them. The houses typology which is there in terms of in the rural sector, in terms of having different housing typologies, that results because of different geological factor, climatical factors, socio-economical factors, traditional construction techniques, and with the invent of modern materials, technologies, people are fascinated to run behind the new technologies, which is very good, but knowingly, half-heartedly, and the implementation is lacking. And as a result, we are not only constructing the houses in the rural sector, but they are contributing to increase the database on the vulnerable buildings in rural sectors. So that we need to protect, and this is the program which is one step forward to reduce this. As very rightly pointed out by Negi Sahab, that traditional houses are very good. They have been emerged out after a great insight by our ancestors, But unfortunately, if I take a case of Himachal Pradesh, wherein around 4% of houses were there, in traditional houses were there in 2010, and as of now, they have been diminished to hardly 0.2 to 0.25%. So with this background, I would like to take my journey to the current construction practices. And when you see the typical houses, typical view of villages in our country, specifically my emphasis will be on in Himalayan region, because this particular region is susceptible to moderate to severe seismic hazard. Apart from this seismic activity, it is susceptible, it might be susceptible to the landslide, mud wash, so on and so forth. So when we talk about these villages, which looks like to be very beautiful when you capture in the camera, but we have to take and strengthen them further in years to come. And for that purpose, as mentioned by Negi sir, that different construction technologies are being deployed in different regions. It is similar as our accent changes in our country. Same thing is happening in the construction practices also. Some people are using bricks, few people will be using concrete blocks, hollow concrete blocks, AAC blocks, so on and so forth. But majority locations, when you see, the foundations are being done in hilly regions using random rubble masonry, either in the mud or cement mortar. Very few cases lime mortar is being used. Wallings as a load bearing structures, because most of the buildings are 2 to 3 storied, so they are primarily stone masonry in hilly regions. Sometimes it is made use of brick masonry also, but they are quite expensive because of transportation costs. So alternative to that is the concrete blocks, hollow concrete blocks, and nowadays precast panels are also coming in market, which can also be deployed. But before doing so, we need to understand what are the important engineering perspective we have to look into. And this is one of the typical walling system which is being used in hilly regions. When you look at the architecture and planning type of buildings in the rural sectors, typically it is material and climate centric, typically again square or rectangular in shape, load bearing, sloping roof with light weight materials. Maximum height is around 9 to 10 feet, that is 2.5 meters to 3 meters. But in the story of a modernization, in a case of a modernizations, now we are noticing that the RCC frame structures are also coming up in the rural sector, which is primarily using the material like RCC brick masonry, RCC roof, CGI sheet at a few places. But engineering interventions or in the engineering knowledge is not going in detail. Without in consulting to the engineers, half-heartedly it is being constructed, and that is the result. Cost is involved there, but only at the same time it is giving a status symbol to the occupants, but they are putting themselves into trouble. And for that purpose, we have to understand the engineering behind it, and if at all required, we need to consult to the engineers, architect, and in case of a big projects, to the team of engineers. So before going into detail, my A, B, C, D, E of civil engineering for day-to-day construction activities would be: A is for anchorage, B for bracing, C for connections, D for durability in case of material perspective, and from connectivity point of view, reinforcement, deformability point of view, ductility is very important aspect need to be understood. Then whenever you are taking a very challenging project or of that kind, then you should understand the exposure specifically in the hilly regions. If there is a need, please consult the experts, and foundation should never be ignored. If you honor this A to F, definitely you will lead to good construction practices, good infrastructure, good housing for the people of the country. So when you talk about the hazard, there are multi-hazard. Our country is susceptible to multi-hazard scenario in most of the regions. Around 57% of land is susceptible to moderate to severe shaking. So for that purpose, a design philosophy of earthquake resistant design clearly spells out that under minor shaking, maybe a magnitude of up to 3 to 4 on a Richter scale, there should not be any damage on a structural or non-structural members. In case of a moderate shaking, maybe a magnitude ranging from 4 to 5.5 on a Richter scale, there could be a structural damage, but no collapse should be there. Whereas under the severe shaking, great earthquakes having magnitude 5.5 plus, there could be a damage in the structural and non-structural members, but building should not collapse. Primarily, the emphasis of our earthquake resistant design also spells out that we are allowing our buildings to go under damage, cracks, but at no cost it should collapse. That is life safety, collapse prevention, disaster risk reduction by means of loss of business should be minimized. Again, we should give emphasis on reducing the again occupying time. So before going to that, whenever we are constructing, we are planning to construct a building in a hilly region particularly, so we should see first of all important aspect, that is sitting. How to ascertain a hilly slope is stable or not? For small buildings it is very difficult, and they cannot afford to go and consult the geotechnical engineers or geologists. So for that purpose, some of the tips I would like to mention, that whenever you are selecting a site for your building, please see that it should be far away or slightly away from the steep slopes. Slopes should not be more than 30 degrees. Houses on a steep slope should be small, light in weight. Further, generally it is asked in the, when you go to the villages, what should be the sequence of the construction in hilly region, particularly on a hill slopes. Answer is very simple, that whenever you would like to construct houses in a hilly slope, construct a heavier mass houses on a downhill side, and whereas on uphill side lightweight structure should be constructed. Sequence of construction, first of all, first construct the houses on the downhill side, thereafter on the uphill side. So this is how you have to keep in mind, that the sequence of construction should be honored. But due to unscientific, unplanned fashion, people are constructing the houses the way they likes and they thinks. So this should not be taken it granted. Again, very important aspect which should be seen, the suitable site for foundations. So foundations, so that is why one has to be very particular before initiating its construction, that how my building will be sitting on a ground. So what is the geologic, what are the type of geological layers? So that in summary, what is the dip angle, or how the slopes of the different geological layers are going. Houses should be built preferably on those hills slopes where the geological layers on rock slopes inside the body of the hill. It should not be along, construction should not be done parallel to the hill slopes. So this is very important, otherwise this our foundations are susceptible to the sliding. Whenever you are trying to construct your houses in such kind of a region, so please try to make sure that adequate foundation depth should be given. The supporting member should be given proper braced, not only the horizontal fashion but also in the diagonal fashion, so that adequate stiffness and flexibility can be offered to the superstructure. In addition to that, whenever you are selecting a site in a hilly region, please make sure that do not construct or do not select your site which interrupts the natural waterway. Means waterway should be, means you should understand and study the general geography of the region. What you should not, or you should restrain yourself by constructing your houses on a waterway. build retaining walls to prevent the local failures from upfills, as well as to protect your buildings from any kind of a runoff, if at all it comes. So protection measures, adequate protection measures need to be done. You should found your building on a proper hard strata. Levels of the building should be honored. Geology of the site should be studied very intelligent fashion. Further, the symmetricity and simplicity, whether it is a house or in a human being, is need to be understood. If you are simple, you will be more successful. That similar philosophy applies to the buildings also. If your building shapes are very simple, it will definitely perform exceptionally better manner in case of an earthquake or any other kind of a external forces. So for that purpose, avoid using of irregular shapes. If at all you need to construct the irregular shape, the way you can see in this particular picture, so this is likely to be or more susceptible to the damage because of torsional effect at the intersections of the two perpendicular plan of the building, and that's why avoid the corners. And if at all it is required, it should be connected by means of a non-structural element or temporary. Another important aspect which need to be understood, particularly in the rural sector, is the level of clinth level of your house. Whenever you are constructing your house, you please try to first of all understand the high flood level in the region, and based on that you demarcate the plinth level of your house. In general, a thumb rule which normally being taken is that around 1 to 1.5 feet, that is 450 up to 450 mm, your plinth level should be there from the existing road level. If and whatever is the maximum, you have to first of all compare all these parameters, and then based on that you try to fix up the plinth level of your house. So this may be look like a very simple thing. In case of a flooding, this could be a disaster, and you may lose a lot of occupancy as well as your internal damages in your house. Another important aspect which has to be understood is what precaution should be taken in the foundation from earthquake resistant point of view. As I mentioned earlier also, whenever you are constructing a building on a plain ground, it should be adequately connected by means of a beams at foundation level itself. Not only in the plinth level, but foundation should also be connected when it is founded on a slopy ground. At the same time, when you are constructing your house on a slopy terrain, in that case you need RC frame or wooden frame, but such frame should be connected horizontally as well as diagonally also, so as to have your substructure more stiff as well as more flexible in case of a lateral motions. But do not construct any walls in substructures, because it may likely to happen that due to excessive water flow it may get washed off. So please do not construct any walls in the substructures. Construct RC frames or wooden frame adequately braced, adequately connected with each other. It is very typical question which type of building we should construct in earthquake prone areas. Philosophy says that you should honor first of all the lightweight materials. You should deploy the lightweight materials in construction, and also the ABCDEF, whatever I said, that need to be. But that if you are constructing your house maybe in the masonry or in a RCC, then all these measures you need to take into account. If it is a load bearing structures, masonry building, then you have to provide all different kind of a bands at appropriate level. Such bands are basically 100 mm thick in case of a 400. It is basically mandatory features in buildings which is made of reinforced concrete bands provided with 100 mm thick or 75 mm thick in seismic zone 4 with nominal 2 8 mm dia reinforcement. And if the building is located in seismic zone 5, then you have to provide minimum 150 mm thick RC bands with 410 mm dia bar. Again, you have it, the reinforcement detailing depends upon the what is the length of your wall and how many story you are going. So for that purpose, you may have a reference of table 6 from IS 4326 2013. Apart from that, how another simple question people are asking when you go to the rural sector, that how many types of earthquake bands are used in reinforced concrete masonry buildings? So definitely the horizontal bands, first of all, we need to understand what is the purpose of providing bands. Basically, bands are provided to give an integral box action to your entire house. And for that purpose, you have to put this particular bands, as I have detailed in the previous slide, at different levels, either on the plinth, that is on the plinth level, sill level, lintel level, and also in the roof level in case of a sloping roof. In case of a RCC slabs, the such roof band is not required. Your masonry walls is very important, because normally when you go to the villages, you see a very thin wall, very long walls, and it is getting collapsed, even not susceptible to even when it is susceptible to slight ground movement. So then in this case, slenderness of wall should be looked into adequately. A thumb rule and code also says that height to thickness or length to thickness ratio should be less than 70. If at all you have to apply or implement such kind of walls in your building systems, either provide a cross walls or a masonry buttresses at appropriate locations, so that the height to thickness or length to thickness ratio is that is also is within the limit, that is less than 17. So as I mentioned, if you are moving to the RCC frame buildings, then it is very important that it should be designed properly. Consult your engineer, architect, and after designing, construct them properly, because simply designing is not done. You have to construct the buildings properly, and for that purpose, reinforcement placement detailing is very, very important. Whether it is a building or a human being, joints are very critical, and as a result, you have to take adequate measures to tie your reinforcement adequately at the beam column joints. 99% cases you will find that the impetus is given on the that in the current practice, the reinforcement is just left at the beam column joints. No proper anchorage is given, which is not correct. And the way it is shown in this particular drawing or slide, which is basically a ductile detailing, which has been clearly spelled out in our IS 1390, need to be adopted. That means the top bars of your beams is to be bent down and bottom bars to be bent to the top. The length of this anchorage should be minimum 60 times the diameter of the bar. Again, the detailing of the column should be done properly. And if it is done properly, then only the RCC construction should be termed as earthquake resistant design and construction. But construction doesn't make you sound or make you safe. At the same time, you have to maintain your buildings properly during its service life. But when you talk about during the construction, you should ensure that adequate and proper quality of material is also implemented. And for that purpose, you may need to consult your engineer, architect, and for that purpose, yes, codes are also there. And right from stacking to implementation, you have to see very honestly. So quality assurance is also very important whenever you are talking about the new construction. When you are talking about the big buildings, which is also sometimes coming up in the rural sectors as a panchayat bhavan or community centers. So in such cases, it is very essential that you may consult not only the architect, but structural engineer, but also the other MEP engineers, that's electrical, plumbing, sanitary, fire, so on and so forth. Now we are focusing more on the existing building, on the new construction, but at the same time we need to look into the what is the status of my existing buildings. If you have any doubt, please consult the structural engineer who will come study your buildings, assess the vulnerability of your buildings, and if it is vulnerable really, he will suggest you appropriate retrofitting technique. I do not have that much time to talk on that particular topic, but I cannot refrain myself to discuss something about the confined nursery, which is a very good concept, particularly from the village point of view, because this particular technology makes use of locally available construction materials, skills, and it is a very cost effective and disaster resilient. And that's why this is the only technology in view of the whatever the constraint or constraint I have discussed so far. So this is the ideal technology which can be promoted in the rural sector for upcoming housing projects, which this particular technology is mostly applicable to low to medium rise building. Up to 3 to 4 story can be easily constructed. What exactly confined masonry is, if you need to understand, it is very simple. You can take a encouragement from this particular photograph that one wall is there and it is embraced with by means of a tree, and even if a bulldozer comes and strikes, that wall doesn't get damaged. So that is the importance of embracement by some strong element. So if we take that particular concept forward, and if we apply that concept in our masonry work, which we normally adopt in our rural sector, and that being an engineer, we have reinforced concrete element is our friends to embrace the masonry, which is heterogeneous. And for that purpose, if we simply embrace this masonry panel by means of a lightly reinforced, nominally reinforced rather RC element, then definitely that particular system is called as a confined masonry system, confined masonry walls. And such walls, if we make use of in your construction of houses in rural sector in particular, definitely we will be generating a very robust houses in our rural sectors. How the construction has to be done, it is similar, it is basically hybrid, it is a combination of your masonry buildings as well as RCC frame buildings. So once the building construction is completed, then it looks like the RCC frame buildings. So nowadays there is a status symbol. If you are residing in a RCC frame building, you are rich, so your aspiration is also fulfilled. But before that, you need to understand how the confined masonry construction is taken place. It is matter of sequence of construction in which simple reinforcements are erected at appropriate locations, particularly at the corners and around the openings first, then right from foundation, and then the masonry is done up to certain height, maximum up to 1.2 meters, by leaving a grooves which is having a width of 25 mm to 40 mm, that is 1 inch to 1.5 inch. Once the certain masonry work is done, then provide the shuttering on the two faces and then pour the concrete. As a result, you are providing adequate bond between the masonry and the RC element. And once you complete this particular process, then entire masonry is embraced within the RC element, and as a result, you are giving new building technology. And it is not mandatory that you should use the burnt clay brick units. For representation, in this particular slide, I have shown you the burnt clay brick unit. You can use fly ash bricks, concrete blocks, hollow concrete blocks, or even AAC blocks and panels. And if you do not like to use the to give the grooves, alternatively, what you can do, you can provide 10 mm dia bars, 400 mm long. It might be available as a wastage for you, but it can be provided at all intersection passing through the tie column, which further connects between the two walls with each other along with the tie columns. So in this case, the vertical elements are called as a tie column, horizontal elements are called tie beam. It cannot be called as a RC columns or RC beam, because there is a great departure in designing of such elements from our basic code of IS 456. So this is how the good construction practices has to be implemented while constructing a confined masonry buildings. So apart from that, now there are innovative materials which are available in the market. So lightweight material like hollow blocks are also used. So all such blocks we have adequately tested, masonry buildings we have tested in our laboratory on a full scale basis, and as a result we have proved that such buildings are more seismic resistant, cost effective, which makes use of locally available construction materials and skill. And the results showed that it is giving lateral strength to the tune of around 3 to 4 times more than the unreinforced masonry buildings. Even such buildings, if at all it damages in a great earthquake, it can be repaired by making use of locally available construction material, that is cement, plastic cement bags. So that also we have implemented in some of the buildings. So takeaway from this particular slide is, if you have your building in rural sector, if you find your building vulnerable, then in that case you cannot go and adopt very expensive technologies, but you can take the plastic cement bags, provide the holes and put those bags on either side and embed within the plaster. Definitely it will provide you better seismic resistant and performance, which has already been proved in experimentally in our laboratory. For further references, you may refer to these literatures which are available at CSIR CBRI website on confined masonry. So with this, again I stop my presentation, but before stopping the presentation or concluding my presentation, I'd like to reiterate on my ABCDE to lead to the good construction practices. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir, for nicely elaborating all the each and every aspect of building materials, from constructions to giving them a way forward that to go with the confined masonry, especially in aspect of rural housing. Thank you, sir. And now for our last lecture on fire safety in rural context, I welcome Rajesh Chandra Sharma, sir. Sir is a fire safety and disaster management expert, and he is a former director of Delhi Fire Services, Government of India. With over 40 years of his experience in fire safety management, he passionately worked towards building fire safety awareness and capabilities of professionals through his technical education. Sir has provided leadership to over 1,700 staffs and officers in monitoring fire safety arrangements all across the capital and fighting fires. With this, I welcome you, sir, for your lecture, and over to you, sir.
Okay, thank you. You can bring my presentation.
Yes, sir.
Because time is short, I try to just attach the main points from the time.
Yes, sir.
Like every program.
Like every webinar, sir. We cannot stop, sir.
When the building is complete and everything is built, then fire service is not called. So it does happen.
Also, it's a request, so you have to be a bit loud because your voice is coming very faint.
Okay, is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Better, sir.
Okay. Well, you can come to the
so it is, you are able to share and see the screen, sir?
I can see the screen. Go to the next slide.
Yogita is a PPT mode. Mein le aayi.
Okay, go to the next.
हाँ यहीं पे क्लिक करिए यस
नेक्स्ट
थैंक यू
नेक्स्ट स्लाइड प्लीज ओके आई थिंक समथिंग डेफिनेशंस इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड व्हेन समथिंग हैपेंस एंड वी कैनॉट रियली डील And there can be big loss of life or property, so there's disaster. And everything is possible. I mean, you have earthquake, landslides, floods, cyclone, leakage of gas, chemicals. Things are happening in Andhra. We have got Andhra Pradesh. We had some incident of industrial problems with that also. Pandemic like COVID we are going through, these all are disasters, and the fires is also one of them. So I'll be confining my thing to fires because we have got all technical experts sharing their things. Already they have done it. Next, please. Next slide, please.
So I did next, but it's not moving. So let me start once again because it was not moving.
Try from here.
Sir, please continue. If it is coming, sir, then.
My slide or your slide?
Sir, are you able to see my slide, sir?
This is Yogita's slide, so you can continue.
Right, it's okay. Yes, so the urban sector is understood to be well organized. I mean, whatever we say is that to have all the plans for the urban areas. We have got building rules, building regulations, national building codes. So everything is being followed. So there is no problem so far as urban area is concerned. But in the rural sector, we lack a lot of things over there because we don't have that sort of rural planning that is considered. And in fact, we have seen that only one state I have come across, that is the Kerala, where they've got a panchayat building regulations, and where they do have things to be approved by panchayat for the construction in the villages. So there is a different arrangement, but the rest of the places I don't find anything. So probably that may be the reason that we don't have planned things going to the into the rural areas, and probably more problems when we have got some bigger incident happening there. We do have the different regions. So like we have discussed the hilly region in all the presentations. So there are different types of problems. In coastal areas, we have got all together different, and the plains, flood plains, and maybe other areas near the industries, villages are there nearby. So they do have different problems in different areas. So it is depending upon their physical or geographical situation that we have to take care of whatever risk they are vulnerable, and they can go, they can have the problems, and they have to plan for that. Next, please.
So I think there's an issue with going it next in the full screen. So I'm just.
I don't have many slides, 6 or 7 slides are there.
So Yogita, you can come out of this and.
Yes, sir. I'm just.
In fact, when we talk about the rural sector, yes. So when we talk about this urban sector, even the many of the states say still they do not enforce
the national building. Sharma sir, आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही है clearly.
देखो अभी आ रही है.
हाँ, slightly better, but
okay.
Yes.
Is that okay now?
Slightly better, sir.
Is it okay? So now, what I say is that when we talk about the fire safety, especially, we have got whatever 34, 35 states are there. In that, still we do have many states which do not have implemented the National Building Code Part 4. They don't have any act or rules to enforce these things. So that is the problem. If we are not able to do that in the urban areas in the most many of the states. So going in the rural areas in those states will be entirely something thinking of too much. So that is the problem here. And probably now what we are trying is that if we are able to enforce certain rules and regulations, then we can probably do something for that. Next slide, please. So when we talk about fire risk in any area that is directly related to the presence of the material which is capable of burning. Now it may be building material which the building is constructed of, or it may be the material which is stored inside, stacked inside, or used in construction, or maybe the surroundings are having certain material which can burn very fiercely. forest areas, if there is nearby in the hilly area, probably we do have bigger problems. In some other countries like Australia and US, we had seen that forest fires are consuming many, many villages and population and many big mansions of film industries in US. They were all destroyed because of the forest fires. So they were very good big mansions in that those areas, very highly priced, but because of the forest fire and because of things went out of control, and it was really a big sort of a disaster there. So everything has turned to ashes. So things can go wrong where we have anything to burn. It may be urban or rural. It's an altogether different thing. But when it comes to fire, the loss can be very colossal if there is a, something which can burn. And once the things start and they go out of control very fast. Now, new housing, if they are planned properly, things do not go to bad to worse, but they can be controlled. And especially the, when we talk about wooden houses, I think the thick wooden logs and beams and columns, they are not really that much affected by fire in the beginning. Once the fire gains big proportion, then they add to the fire. But initially, they do not. They are not a big fire hazard as such, because thick wooden logs, they are not easy to be. We cannot start them to burn easily. We need some other smaller things to burn very fiercely, then they can be involved in fire. So to that extent, if wood is used in construction, it's not really that bad. It's got many advantages, especially the, in case of earthquake and all that. In the total our northern region, when we have got all the earthquake-induced areas, and they are seismically very active, so probably I think their wooden housing is very much desirable to avoid the loss of life and all that due to the collapse of the building structure. So that is very much okay. And in this different type of seasons, I mean, different things happen. When we talk about plains, normally the summer season when foresting season is there, that is the most difficult, and we do get number of fire incidents in the rural area also. Delhi is not very rural in that sense, but in about 2009 or 10, we had 22 fire incidents on a single day on crop fire. And very next day after that, we had 14 incidents. It was quite a very long dry spell, and the crops were ready for harvest to be harvested. And we had some fire incidents of that level. So now it is not happening regularly. I don't know what was the reason for that, but it so happened that we had so many incidents in this consecutive 2 or 3 days. So that's one area that things can go wrong. And when we talk about rural areas, when the crop season is there, we have got villages extending up to the, and on the edge of the village, we have got farms or crops which are standing dry and completely to be cut and harvested. So if something goes wrong in the crops, in the outside the area in the house where you have got bushes or something which is dry, normally April, May, June, the season is such that everything is bone dry and less humidity, and probably something starts and we got a strong wind velocity also is there in that in those days. So things can go from bad to worse in a few minutes. And then when talking about dealing with those things or be prepared for that, it's very, very difficult because you don't expect anything to come from outside. Next slide, please. I mean, we are waiting for some fire brigade to come. They may be 20 kilometers or 15 kilometers away. By the time they come, take 15, 20 minutes. The time is good enough for everything to be burned down. So that is something that in the rural areas, we have to be planning everything that things have should be taken care of, clear of the things around the villages, around the houses, so that fire in the surrounding area doesn't come to the houses. Storage, whatever do we are doing in the houses, like fodder, like because wood, nowadays people have got electricity or gas or to their houses, but we have been having some of the areas still which use the firewood for cooking, etc. And they store it for the rest of the year. And it is very close to the house or in the same house. They've got a house where they keep all the kettles and animals, and there again, for fodder also is to be kept. So if the things are not kept separately, they are in the same area, then probably they can be a big fire risk. So that planning in that rural area is very much necessary. Now under the Prime Minister, this, some of the things like LPG distribution cylinders given to the poor people, I think that is okay, it's one good job. But now LPG is can be one of the reasons for creating even explosions. If it is not handled properly, there is some leakage, or they don't know how to handle it, what to do in case there is some leakage due to some reason. So that again is a part of the our education to the rural masses. Whenever such things are given, they are extended to them, electrification is done, new electricity wires or current, they don't know much about it. So they have to be told about electrical safety, how to deal with, how to take care of those things, their own safety, and again from the fire also. Then some normal education is required, like that, what the causes of fire, like cooking, heating, smoking, using open lamps, candles, electrical origin fires. But they have to be just told about these things. So now we don't have a very regular structure that these things are to be shared with them, or they need to be appraised with all these things. So since other things, long planning we need for house building and construction, perfectly right. So there again, what I was thinking, that if we are giving a lot of Prime Minister Awas Yojana in the rural area, we are giving them a loan for constructing house. But if they construct house in the areas, because they need land first, if they got some land in a low-lying area and they build a house over there itself, we are again in a problem if there is a flood in that particular area. So I think what I was thinking, that there, it must, if it is already taken care of into the, when we are giving loan to these people to take care of this, if it is well and good. Otherwise, I think that need to be incorporated into the system, that wherever loans are given, at least in those areas which are flood prone or which are in the risk areas, they should be told to shift to the some better suitable location, and land also may have to be applied for those areas. Lack of good communication, approach roads, emergency support facilities, that's a big problem in the rural area. They have got narrow roads, and now I think the roads are also coming up well because of the connectivity being created by the government. So that once that comes perfectly, we'll be having much more faster things. But still, I think we cannot have the facilities extended, the firefighting facilities extended to the rural areas. So they will have to have their own arrangement, maybe something like using the resources which they do have, like even tube wells, using the tube well connections and having some hoses for that purpose. Maybe some government help would be given in that regards, and some, like we do have already sort of people taking up the job. So that also could be just given at that way. Some force can be created like this, doing already job and like this. So soil, water, and whatever is to be used by them, lake, pond, I mean, everything goes dry in summer season. So we got a problem for, water for the crops, or even for drinking water. So that becomes a problem. So firefighting water, again, having that is a big question. I don't know how far it is possible, but yes, I think we have to think all these things in terms of when we are planning for any safety for the rural area. Next, please. So what needs to be done is that there need to rural housing to be safe, and will depend on the initial planning, basic awareness about the possible risk hazard to be, which normally are there in that particular area. And this need to be brought under the control of some agency like panchayats, so that whatever is being done, because our main problem is that they don't have straight roads. They don't have wide enough roads where a fire engine or any other bigger vehicle can go. So probably some rule regulation, if it's enforced through panchayats or whatever is there, then at least accessibility will be there. And things very close to each other, again, can be a problem. So that probably some regulations, if they are enforced, they will help. And public awareness about the natural abandonment hazard disaster in the surrounding, that is very much necessary. Because even if there is a habitat which has come around the industry, and probably people are living there. So now knowing about the whatever is the hazard with the industry, and if there is something leaks, some gas is there, knowing about the wind direction, the problem which they should act or should not act, get out of their houses or stay in the houses, that sort of things. Now this again, it's a very big disasters when you talk about man-made disasters, rural or urban. So then again, if there is the urban, rural area, then they are exposed to more problems, and probably they have to be self-sufficient on these things, and more awareness has to be brought in. I think this is what I could share, because in the rural sector, we don't have much on the fire safety. So this, I could just have my ideas on these particular areas. I think that's okay.
Thank you so much, sir, for nicely describing the way forward for mitigating the risk in rural areas. Just for your knowledge, as well as for sharing with the participants, Jammu and Kashmir recently has come out with a scheme of developing a force of volunteers for firefighting at local level, village panchayat level. So they are in the process of providing some sort of equipments to panchayats, as well as training the volunteers
Yeah, in fact, there is a provision in the Fire Act in all the states that they can have a volunteer fire service, auxiliary fire service, and they can just provide them assistance also. I mean, through the equipment to be given to them and giving some training, and that is possible. Yes, that's what I meant for this.
So they have already taken this initiative, and very recently they are coming up with these type of solutions. So thank you so much, sir. Yogita ji, you can take those questions which you were raising earlier.
Okay, thank you, Sharma sir. We have two raised hands, so let me just go to one of the participants. Participant C.S. Gupta, if you're there, you can raise your question.
Yeah, hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yeah, hi. My name is C. Sen Gupta. I'm from Delhi. I'm an architect come town planner. My question is, every construction that we do needs to have not just disaster check, also affordability check. Because in India, the income disparity index is too high. Based on various reports, only 3% of the people in this country have about 73% of the wealth. Rest all of us are basically have to satisfy with 27% of the income of the country. Now, very rough calculations say that average income would be not more than 3,000 to 10,000 rupees per family. Okay, it is not so the case for office going people, because office going people actually reflect about 10 to 15% of the urban population. About 60 to 70% people are in the informal sector, and the entire rural belt is also the primarily informal sector.
गुप्ता साहब क्वेश्चन
बताइए। हाँ जी, मैं चाहता हूँ कि अफोर्डेबिलिटी मैप होना चाहिए, चाहे कोई भी टेक्नोलॉजी हो, कि एट द एंड ऑफ द डे टोटल कॉस्ट ऑफ कंस्ट्रक्शन उस जगह पे क्या होगा बेस्ड ऑन द इनकम डिस्पैरिटी।
सो इट्स अ कमेंट और अ क्वेश्चन?
इट्स अ क्वेश्चन, बिकॉज़ आई हैवंट सीन एन अफोर्डेबिलिटी मैप। I'm aware of the disaster map done by BMTPC, because I was also associated with some of the activities long time ago.
Okay, this is one question. Affordability we will take.
Shall I answer? Amir, no, shall I answer?
Please go ahead. Please go ahead, sir.
It's a very good question. Let me tell you that in order to promote new construction technologies, we all are aware that if you have to compare conventional vis-a-vis new technologies are a bit on a higher side, because they are yet to be mainstream. Once they are mainstream, they will be they will be cheaper than the conventional cost of construction. And despite the fact that there are added advantages of life cycle cost, less maintenance, better disaster resilience, and things like that, but as Indians, we are always moved by costs. So what the government of India has done in order to promote these new technologies, under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, we provide it's called TIG, Technology Innovation Grant. So if any state comes up with an innovative construction housing project using new technologies, so 20% of the dwelling unit cost, up to 2 lakh maximum, is given upfront as a technology innovation grant, so as to promote new technologies. So this is one way we are trying to mainstream, and I'm pretty sure once the technologies are mainstream and there are more and more factories are set up, then these technologies will be at par with conventional and with a lot of advantages. So that is the answer.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yogita, you can ask another one.
Yes, participant Sameer, if you are there, kindly raise your question. Mr. Sameer?
Mr. Sameer, are you there? Please go ahead.
Okay, sir. So from the raised hands, we have just two. We have few questions in the chat box, like why are we not restricting allowing constructions in riverbed areas and low-lying areas and the dangerous riverbeds?
Chaurasia sir, आपके आपके सवाल को repeat कर दिया है, आपकी slide को. Question is, why we can't build a house in riverbed areas?
So the question is, why are we not restricting the building of the houses?
So restrictions, yeah, very good question. The restrictions are there, clearly demarcated by the authorities. For example, government of Uttarakhand says that you cannot construct any habitat 200 meters from the center line of the river. But unfortunately, everything is not being understood by the owner as well as by the authority, and they are constructing it. So knowledge is, implementation lacuna is there. So all the stakeholders have to come in front, and whatever the guidelines are there, they should abide to those guidelines.
Just to add that it's not safe for earthquake safety point of view. In simple terms, we can say only this.
Sorry. It is not only flood, earthquake safety, because probably in the riverbeds, possibility of liquefaction is there. But yes, apart from that, when you see, talk about flooding, so there could be flooding, washout may happen due to high water levels.
Yeah, multiple hazards destroy the structure. And what Sharmaji was mentioning, it is exactly the same. I was also seeing one question about rural land use planning, that especially those infrastructure facilities like schools, which are coming from government grants, are built in those low-lying areas, and the lands which are not suitable. I have seen in several states that this type of things. So this is the area where we need to invest a lot and work in this area. So Shailesh ji, aapse mera sawal ye hai, how to regulate the construction practices in rural areas? Sharma ji mentioned about Kerala Building Regulation Act in for rural areas. Sir.
I think bahut acha question hai aapka, and like when we talk about regulation, we fail as a society. And ji, I always say, see, I've been working in the area of disaster resistant construction. I think Sharma ji also presented very well. You know, safety is not there in our culture. I have to say this. And you know, Professor Jain, once he told me, ki Shailesh, jab tere ghar mein bachcha hua, to jo niche switching lagi hui thi, usme tape lagaya tha tune. Maine kaha nahi sir. Bole kabhi socha ki ye bachcha ungli de sakta hai? Jo electric switches hote hain, but chota sa bachcha ghumta hai, so we are not concerned about safety. Safety has come from all these stakeholders, you know, from everyone around. So regulation, unless it comes from us, you know, like I always say that if you are living in a society in Noida, suppose, why don't you ask as a resident welfare association, your developer, that please tell me whether my house is safe or not. The moment you tell him that, like some sort of regulation is coming in urban areas through RERA. You know, we have a RERA Act now. To all participants, let me tell you that we have a RERA. See, I think Sharma ji is smiling, but I know regulation is difficult, but there are certain checks and balances being put up by Government of India through which regulations are being, not, I would not say enforced, being implemented, but the real success would be when all of us, you know, rely, you know, all of us, you know, from within it comes that India is a country which is vulnerable to earthquakes. We get earthquakes in regions we are not supposed to have earthquakes. So we need to build in, you know, safety in our construction. So regulation, like we have model building bylaws. I think to my participants, let me tell you, all of you must go and visit Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs website, where we have MBBL, Modern Building Bylaw. It clearly, there is a chapter on disaster. There is a chapter on fire, and those model building bylaws, you know, are written at a central level, and all these states need to incorporate the relevant sections in their local bylaws. Another thing is that, unfortunately or fortunately, housing is a state subject. So that is my answer. You know, I again say that what is being sent by President Government. See, everything is there available on net. There are so many good literature. Like we always say that please follow your codes religiously. So it has to come from within. We need to, you know, like Ajay was talking about, that we need to consult a structural engineer. But as of today, when I'm talking to you, I'm being approached by my own, I myself is a structural engineer, my own fraternity, that when will we have licensing of a structural engineer in India? What about competence? So there are a whole lot of issues, you know, problem. Competence is another issue. Everybody talks about earthquake resistant construction despite of getting the formal training on earthquakes. That is my another, you know, worry. So capacities, although we are talking about capacities, but we don't have enough capacity. Like in innovative technologies are struggling to, you know, mainstream these technologies because we don't have capacities, we don't have enough designers, architects who can work on these areas. So same is with disaster.
Okay. नहीं सर शर्मा जी पहले आप बोलिएगा फिर मैं बताऊंगा
जस्ट आई वाज ट्राइंग टू से दैट वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट रूरल सेक्टर इज यस इट इज वेरी फार अवे फ्रॉम अस बट अंडर आवर नोज वी व्हेन वी सी इन दिल्ली आई मीन आंध्र इज कॉलोनीज वी हैव गॉट आई थिंक 2000 मोर देन 2000 एंड कंस्ट्रक्शंस आर स्टिल गोइंग ऑन आंध्र इज द सिंगल ब्रिक वॉल थ्री स्टोरी फोर स्टोरी फाइव स्टोरी स्ट्रक्चर विद एक्सटेंडेड बालकनीज एंड ऑन द एज ऑफ द बालकनी यू हैव गॉट अ वॉल एक्सटेंडेड आई मीन दीस थिंग्स आर हैपनिंग आई मीन okay for the buildings conducting some test conducting some check or this is a different thing but here it is happening and visibly things are visibly they are so dangerous and we are not able to check and it's not one area these are so many colony and maybe lakhs of houses are just like that and population inside is huge so we are in zone 4 and that everybody is knowing government is knowing everybody still we are not stopping that it's still going and compounding I mean, okay, for the regular areas, for planned areas, we are talking, we do retrofitting. But here, no retrofitting is feasible, I think. We have to redo everything. Some, they started something, 5, 6, maybe 8, 10 places. But the so huge area requirement, I mean, it's very difficult. I don't know. It's a big area, of course.
Shailesh ji, jo aap bata rahe the, aur jo Sharma ji ne bataya, कि मेरी जो सेफ्टी है ना वो मेरा कंसर्न नहीं है आग जो है ना हमेशा बराबर वाले के घर में लगती है सो ये जो सेफ्टी का जो सिंड्रोम है ना ये हमारे फंडे बिल्कुल गोल है
yes. तो
जब तक हम इस पे चेताएंगे नहीं और जब तक हम इस पे काम नहीं करेंगे आई डोंट थिंक वी आर मूविंग एट बहुत सारी चीजें ऑलरेडी अवेलेबल हैं बट क्या करें और कैसे करें यस्टरडे इन वन ऑफ दी पैनल्स समवन आस्क्ड कि मैं अपना एक अपार्टमेंट खरीदना है उसको कैसे इंश्योर करें कि वो अर्थक्वेक डिजास्टर सेफ है या नहीं है सर अगर इसको एनलाइटन आप कर दें दो स्ट्रक्चर इंजीनियर यहाँ पे बैठे हुए हैं कि कैसे उसको इंश्योर करें कि मुझे अगर अपार्टमेंट खरीदने जाना है तो क्या करना है
अच्छा शुड आंसर वी हैव डेवलप्ड द डिटेल्ड मेथोडोलॉजीज फॉर दिस काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स आई थिंक अच्छा यू शुड आंसर
और ये जो ना मैं इंजीनियरिंग पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से नहीं पूछ रहा हूँ एज ए लेमैन पूछ रहा हूँ मैं अपना सारी जिंदगी का पैसा उसमें लगाने जा रहा हूँ तो मैं क्या देखूं एज ए कॉमन मैन
सीबीआरआई हैज दैट काइंड ऑफ गाइडलाइन आल्सो वी एंड अजय आई एंड अजय डेवलप दैट काइंड ऑफ थिंग आल्सो इनफैक्ट फॉर दिल्ली सीसीबी वल्नरेबिलिटी व्हेन वी वर डूइंग सर्वे वी वर नॉट अलाउड बाय द पीपल टू डू द सर्वे सो वी यू नो वी डिवाइज्ड अ फॉर्म व्हिच वी कैन फिल अप व्हाइल ट्रैवलिंग इन अ कार सो अजय बता योर आंसर रियली सो अजय विल टेल यू
Yeah, it is very rightly pointed out by Bhaiya. So now the question is very good that what should I look into when I am thinking of buying a flat? So first of all, being an illiterate person in this particular subject, one should go have a drawings from the buyer, from the contractor, builder, whoever it is, and then not only the architectural but also structural. And better way to consult the competent structural engineer, get him, get it checked thoroughly. And whatever he say, let us follow that. And thereafter, you have RERA and other regulations that is always there. So better way to consult a competent structural engineer, take his advice and guidance. And at the same time, we are missing most of the times, construction is being done, but documentation is very poor. So whether the construction has been done as per the design which has been envisaged by the structural engineer at the design office. So that also need to be understood. So for that purpose, again, one has to conduct certain tests at the time of pouring, after the pouring. So those quality assurance certifications should also be taken from the builder. So basically what is happening because of lack of awareness, we are not demanding from the builder and he is also taking excuses in giving. So if we start creating awareness, if we demand from the builder at the time of purchase, I think that will be a good move towards the disaster DRR framework.
बट मैं उसी कंटिन्यूएशन में जो आपने बताया, ये हमने बताया तो जो जिन्होंने हमसे सवाल पूछा था उन्होंने जवाब दिया कि मैंने अपने बिल्डर से पूछा कि ये विंडो क्यों इतनी चौड़ी है, तो इस पे बिल्डर ने बोला कि आप जो है ना किसी दूसरी बिल्डिंग में जाके मकान देखिए. सो बिल्डर्स आर, दिस वाज द आंसर गिवन इन वन ऑफ द डिस्कशंस वी हैड द सेम थिंग.
नो नो सर, आई मिस्ड वन इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट. And for that purpose, we have a very beautifully drafted National Building Code of India 2016, wherein all the sizes and all these procedures are very well laid out. So one can refer to that also.
नहीं नहीं सर, वो सब सही है. But the thing is, जो मैं कहना चाह रहा था कि common man जो है ना परेशान है. अगर किसी को knowledge है थोड़ा सा, वो चेताया हुआ है, वो earthquake safety को तलाश करता है, तो वो उसको नजर नहीं आती है, वो मिलता मिलती नहीं है कि वो क्या बेसिक थंब रूल्स. वही ना, वो स्ट्रक्चरल इंजीनियर अब वो पूरी जिंदगी का पैसा तो लगा रहा है, 40-50 लाख रुपए लगा रहा है, बट वो 20,000 रुपए स्ट्रक्चरल इंजीनियर को नहीं देगा. आपके पास ड्राइंग्स, वो उसको ड्राइंग ही नहीं मिलेगी. जो आप बता रहे हो ये तो हर एक जिसने भी इसमें काम किया है सब इस पे उंगली चली नहीं है सबकी कि वो अंदर बिल्डिंग का. जी
टेक्नोलॉजिकल करना चाहते हैं तो अगर वो अगर इम्प्लीमेंट हो तो तभी. और जैसा डॉक्टर अग्रवाल साहब ने भी कहा कि वी शुड हैव अ एम्पैनलमेंट ऑफ इंजीनियर्स,
यस,
एंड इंजीनियर्स एक्ट टू बी एम्बेडेड. सो दीज आर द चेंजेस व्हिच विल लाइकली टू कम इन अवर सिस्टम आल्सो, इकोसिस्टम आल्सो वेरी सून. सो स्लोली स्लोली थिंग्स आर इम्प्रूविंग.
Just to add, Amir ji, I mean, the question is still left unanswered a bit. You know, we have an Indian standard. Recently, a standard has come. One is 13935 and another standard on masonry, where, you know, in fact, this was the work done by Professor Agra, where we have given rapid visual screening forms.
Yeah.
Now, here, these forms were taken from studies being done abroad. But now, you know, these rapid visual screening forms are nothing but you just give the dimensions of your structure with openings and all these things, and rapidly you will be able to understand the vulnerability of your house. So it is given in code, and in fact NIDN should work on it. I tried. We wanted to convert those rapid visual screening forms mobile app. So on a mobile app, if you put that rapid visual, but somehow it could not take off because I couldn't get funding for that. So that rapid visual screening form, and I wanted Ajay to tell that rapid visual screening form, anyone, even an illiterate person, so quickly ascertain the seismic vulnerability of your house based on the dimensions and based on the, you know, length to width ratio, height to thickness ratio, and openings. You talked about wide opening. So if it is a masonry structure and if your half of the wall is open, then it is vulnerable to earthquakes. It's a very simple thumb rule. So rapid visual screening for those who do not know anything about earthquakes will be a quick method to ascertain vulnerability.
Okay. Sir, iska to, let's I will speak to you on this, definitely.
In fact, Dr. Agrawal's answer, which and NDMA has recently brought out the RVS form in November 2020 for different typology of the building before and post, pre and post disaster. So those typologies are RCC buildings, masonry buildings, stone masonry buildings, and some traditional buildings also. So those RVS forms, pre and post disasters, are available at the NDMA website, and that can be referred to depending upon the building typology.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Negi saab, are you still there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Haan, sir, aap ye bataiye, rural land use planning ke baare mein, do you have some comments? How to resolve all those issues?
Actually, रूरल जो है ना लैंड यूज प्लानिंग का, एक्चुअली रूरल का अभी कुछ भी नहीं है. मतलब जो भी है, मतलब वो जो बिल्डिंग बायलॉज की बात कर रहा था ना, जैसे उत्तराखंड के लिए तो हमने हिल्स और प्लेन्स के लिए काफी कुछ उसमें डाला हुआ है. अभी तक जो भी है उसी में है. मतलब वी डोंट हैव अ सेपरेट दिस थिंग डॉक्यूमेंट और दिस थिंग, जो भी है बायलॉज में है. मतलब लैंड यूज प्लानिंग जो बायलॉज में दिया हुआ है डिफरेंट, उसके लिए हिल्स और जो है प्लेन में हमने थोड़ा सा उत्तराखंड में है सिर्फ डिफरेंस, बाकी स्टेट्स में तो वो भी डिफरेंस नहीं है. मतलब इट इज सेम फॉर लाइक एवरीवेयर.
नहीं बट सिचुएशन इज रियली रियली वेरी पुअर जो अभी
दैट इज ट्रू.
हाँ ऑक्यूपाइड वो जो लैंडफिल करके जो मकान बना लेते हैं इट्स सच ए प्रिवेलेंट प्रैक्टिस के जो गांवों में पहले पॉन्ड्स होते थे ना उन सबको भर के उसमें मकान बनानी है. स्पेशली इन दिस ये जो हमारा गंगेटिक प्लेन्स है इसमें तो ये कंस्ट्रक्शन प्रैक्टिसेस विद ब्रिक मेसनरी शैलेश जी यू नो इट बेटर सो अल्लाह ही मालिक है सर. इसमें इसके अलावा तो डर लगता है सोच के. सो let's wish yes Sharma sir pata hi ga please.
So just because everybody expert up here on that I want to just do any thumb rule like that we want a single brick wall.
Awaaz nahi aa rahi
hai. Floors can be with this type of structure single brick that how far we can go.
Awaaz nahi aa rahi hai.
No. We can look at beyond at least certainly not able to stand especially like
in sir apna camera off kar dijiyega thoda sa mere mein bandwidth ka issue.
Sharma sir
aapki
voice break hui thi so aap camera off karke ek baar kar denge ki koshish to fir I think your audio will be more clear.
I was asking that in case we do have so many huge constructions I mean millions of that of single brick wall 4.5-inch brick wall and load bearing and they are having construction 3, 4, or even 5 story structures and at lintel level chhaja is there 3 feet on all the 2 sides or 3 sides somewhere. So now how much height up to how much height we can say that this type of construction on a single brick wall masonry construction without column how much we can go single story 2 story or more than that. Thumb rule.
Chomasiya saab. Bataiye sir, thumb rule bataiye.
I can have a look and say that, oh, this is unsafe.
Dr. Debashish.
Is there a calculation?
Do you have some thumb rule?
You take a single back block, main building, block on ground floor.
Do you have that thumb rule ke rural housing mein masonry buildings mein ke kitna uncha ja sakte hain wo jo sharma ji bol rahe the 9 inch ki 14 inch ki ya 4 inch ki deewar pe wo to chale jate hain aur forget about rural areas wo to yahan delhi mein bhi mil jate hain. Mere padas mein ek koi makan bana rahe the unhone pura aise hi bana diya. Maine pucha earthquake safety ka kya hai. Ha earthquake to aata hai pata hai hame.
Aisa nahi hai sir uski wo दीवार की मोटाई डिपेंड करती है आपकी जो यूनिट्स हैं उनकी स्ट्रेंथ पे और मोर्टार जो लगाती है उस पे. अगर तो हमारे कोड ने भी बोला है कि अगर 7 MPa की मिनिमम कॉम्प्रेसिव स्ट्रेंथ होनी चाहिए तो जो कि नॉर्मली नॉर्थ इंडिया में तो 7 MPa मिल जाती है. हालांकि अगर कर्नाटक या बिलो सेंट्रल इंडिया देखेंगे वहां पे ब्रिक की स्ट्रेंथ इतनी नहीं आ पाती. तो अगर हम मोटा पाटी अगर बात करें तो सिंगल स्टोरी हाउस कैन बी कंस्ट्रक्टेड ऑन ए 9 inches अप टू 1 to 2 स्टोरी हाउस. बट इफ यू हैव हाई राइज मैक्सिमम अप टू 4 बियॉन्ड 4
4.5 inch
स्ट्रक्चर्स आर नॉट परमिटेड.
आई एम टॉकिंग सर 4.5 inch नॉट 9 inch.
एंड इज ओके. नो एक्चुअली 4.5 inch इफ यू गो ओनली सिंगल स्टोरी यू कैन गो बट फॉर दैट पर्पस यू हैव टू यूज द कन्फाइंड मेसनरी. Code also permits to that. The code is likely to come, I think, in the next month on confined masonry. That also permits the 4.5 inch wall, but you have to use all the rules and regulations and construction practices which has been given in particular code, but not for beyond 1 story.
Thank you, sir. So let's go for closing and take.
Sir, just I.
Please, please, sir.
राजेश शर्मा जी ने जो क्वेश्चन पूछा था कि देयर आर इन लोड बेयरिंग कंस्ट्रक्शन एक होता है हाफ ब्रिक 4.5 inch इज अ हाफ ब्रिक.
जी जी जी
हाफ ओके. एंड 9 inch इज अ फुल ब्रिक कंस्ट्रक्शन. सो अजय वाज टेलिंग यू इफ यू आस्क मी हाफ इंच यू नो हाफ ब्रिक वॉल कंस्ट्रक्शन 4.5 inch वॉल इज नॉट अ लोड बेयरिंग वॉल एज पर इंडियन स्टैंडर्ड्स. सो इट हैज टू बी स्टॉप. You know, when I came to Delhi, first time I saw in Delhi, people are constructing, you know, upper stories with half, you know, 4.5 inch thick brick wall. So that needs to be stopped because we treat it as a non-load bearing wall. Okay. And if at all you have to do with 4.5 inch wall, then you have to confine it. You have to make it reinforced. Now, the other question asked by him was how high can we go with the, you know, with the load bearing structure or a full 9 inch brick wall. So 9 inch brick wall, if you talk about England and all European countries, they are going as high as 10 story. In Delhi, we have done a construction where we have gone up to G+4 for this 9 inch wall. So it is a full brick wall. Okay, so for a full brick wall in Delhi, all the buildings, you know, less than 15 meters can be constructed, provided we provide, you know, earthquake resisting measures because Delhi falls in zone 4. In fact, we were the technical advisor, and CBRI was technical advisor to that EWS project in Narela, where G+4 load bearing structure is constructed on a full brick wall.
Okay. Thank you. So, Negi Saab, aapke last remark, and we are moving towards the closer now. If you want to add something in one or two sentences, no, your closing remarks.
No, please. No, thanks.
Okay. Sharma Saab, aapke closing remarks and last word.
So thank you. I think I'm well educated. The information I've been given that by, I was considering the buildings in Delhi, especially those unauthorized buildings. They are on single brick, half brick, load bearing. And not only that normal building, they have got extended chaja about 3 feet, and then edge of the cantilever, we have a further building up above that. So that is something by a look of it, I can make out this is really very unstable in case of earthquake, and it's going to be a very big problem. But this is to be brought to the authorities, their knowledge that yes, they should not be keeping quiet about it. They should not regularizing the buildings in these areas with a blind eye. They should have a look how safe they are before doing that.
थैंक यू सर. इट्स ए नेशनल करेक्टर टू कैंटिलीवर के आगे कैंटिलीवर निकाल के पूरी बिल्डिंग को एक कमरा बढ़ा लेना. इट्स ए नेशनल करेक्टर. कहीं भी चले जाइए सब जगह देखने को मिलती है. सो इट्स हाउ टू से आई डोंट नो. अजय जी आपका क्लोजिंग रिमार्क प्लीज. अजय चौरसिया साहब.
यस सर. क्लोजिंग रिमार्क. Yeah. In the end, I would like to say that this is a very good move taken by NDMA and NIDM and PMTPC towards the fulfilling the requirement of SDG goals. And as it has been emerged out, there is a need for skill development, to develop not only at the mason level but at the engineering level also. Competency needs to be developed, and we need to see the disaster not only from earthquake or landslide point of view, but in a multi-hazard resistant point of view. So, and important thing which has emerged from this discussion is that implementation component should be made more strengthened, and you are placed at a very appropriate location who can direct the different stakeholders, particularly the governments, for strategic implementation. And for that purpose, what I should say that the Chandigarh model should be adopted, strict regulations, and this model should not be only restricted to the urban sector, but also similar to the smart cities, smart villages concept should also be emerged out, providing all the amenities to the rural sectors. That will only restrain the migration of people from rural sector to the urban sector, and that's how the quality of life, standard of living and prosperity will grow. So with this I close my remarks. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for nicely describing everything. So we have to go multi-hazard, we have to go for smart villages, but with the prosperity coming in, what I have seen in villages is a lot of investment in housing sector is going, and but without any disaster safe construction practices. So that is the worrying point. जो आपने बताया कोई प्रिकॉशन नहीं लेता है जहां पे वाटर बॉडी को भर के उस पर मकान बना लेते हैं. सो दैट इज वेरी कॉमन. So it's an endless discussion. So Shailesh ji, this is your turn for your last words and closing remark for the webinar.
Okay, thank you very much, Amir ji. I think it was a great platform to share our views on disaster resistant safe housing. And I think most of the things have been covered, but let me just tell you that right now there is a clarion call given by Honorable Prime Minister of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Okay, one thing, Atmanirbhar Bharat. And another thing is we are trying to bring technology transition in the construction sector. And all of us know that India is trying its level best to reach $5 trillion economy. And we all know if in order to reach that $5 trillion economy, housing infrastructure sector is going to play a very, very important role. So housing sector is going to be a big mover. And recently, while inaugurating our lighthouse projects, Honorable Prime Minister called for that we should adopt technologies around the globe and make them indigenous technologies. And at the same time, I think what Negi Ji presented, the local technologies. So right now we are working that we have a lot of local technologies, and he showed a very beautiful slide where he showed the structures in HP being constructed using Kathi Kuni earlier and now how they are being constructed. So the kind of knowledge which we have gained, if we marry that with the local practices which were in vogue earlier, then we are going to have indigenous technologies, indigenous architecture, technologies based on socioeconomic conditions and local listing. So that is the need of the hour, that let's create synergy between what our ancestors gave us, those local practices, local technologies, technologies based on local materials, and the kind of knowledge which we have, the kind of numerical modeling, the kind of other things we have. If we can have a synergy between these two, the day is not far when our technologies will be spread world over. So in this regard, we are also trying to hold Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs Indian Housing Technology Mela. We are calling it Mela. जैसे पहले मेले में होता था कि कोई भी आए और अपना सामान रख जाए, तो we are going to invite all stakeholders in India to come and exhibit their technologies, their local materials, local technologies, local skill in that Mela, and then we'll create a database of all those technologies, building materials, categorize them based on geoclimatic conditions, and if any improvements are required. Like I always say, you see Pahal. In Pahal, what they have done is they have put the housing typology and then they have suggested the improvement. Age-old practice is, how it can be modified so as to, answer your disaster resilience and, multi-hazard construction and things like that. So for me, that is the need of the hour. Let us embrace. There is no harm in taking technologies from outside, globally best practices. That's what we are doing. But try to adapt them for Indian conditions and make them Indian technologies. So that is what is required, because we are very good in construction. It's shown, like you see our temples, you see our monasteries, you see a lot of structures which are built by Indian sculptors, architectures, and engineers. So now it is the time when we need to create synergy between what we know now and what our ancestors did earlier. So let's make a step towards Atmanirbhar Bharat by adopting those technologies and giving those housing technologies and materials to the world. So with this, I will end, and I will thank you, Amir ji, for organizing such a nice webinar. It is really indeed a very meaningful webinar, and we will stay in touch. And I also thank Ajay and Negi ji. I think after a year or so, we are sharing a platform together through you. Thanks to you, Amir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Namaskar.
You have already summarized everything. Like you have to marry those traditional knowledge, traditional wisdom, local construction practices where not disaster safe technology is not existing in traditionally. So we have to marry modern with the whatever existing with the modern techniques. So a lot of scope is there, sir, for improvement of rural housing. And I think under your guidance and leadership and VMTPC level, we are in safe hands, and a lot of new technology is coming. And with your Mela concept, with your so many things, mobile app concepts. So we'll discuss. I will come down and we'll discuss further on these issues. So because we are already exceeding too much of time limit, so I take this opportunity to thank all of you personally before handing over to Yogita for formal vote of thanks. So thank you, sir, for everything, for enlightening us. It's a pleasure to listen all the three or four panelists, especially Shailesh ji sparing too much of time for this. सर जो आप पहले दिन बोल रहे थे ना, आप बताइए सर कि हम ये जो हमने सिलेक्शन किया था और बात की है, मुझे तो बहुत अच्छा लगा. और मैं सुबह से बहुत काम किया था, थका हुआ लग रहा था, बट मेरी सारी थकान चली गई सच में बात करके सुन के पूरे दिन की. सो इट्स सो एनलाइटनिंग एंड इट्स वंडरफुल. थैंक यू अजय जी, थैंक यू शर्मा साहब एंड थैंक यू नेगी जी फॉर एवरीथिंग. प्लीज प्लीज गो एट.
थैंक यू
शैलेश भैया. अभी बोल रहे थे तो मैं डे बिफोर यस्टरडे मोदी जी ने IIT खड़गपुर में जो थ्री सेल्फ बोले उसको रिक्रिएट करना चाह रहा हूँ. थ्री सेल्फ मीन्स सेल्फ अवेयरनेस, सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस एंड सेल्फलेसनेस. अगर ये चीज हमारे सब में इम्बाइब हो जाएगी तो शायद हम कंप्लीटली DRR को फुलफिल कर सकते हैं
और रूरल हाउसिंग को भी ठीक कर लेंगे.
वेरी वेल सर,
सब कुछ कंप्लीट
जी. थैंक यू. सो योगिता, यू हैव टू से फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स प्लीज.
Thank you so much. For as a formal vote of thanks, I, Yogita Gribal from NIDM side and also incorporating with BMTPC, I thank all the patrons, our dignitary speakers for today's program and the participants as well. Starting with the patrons, our Executive Director, Major General Manoj Kumar Bindal sir, for his guidance, and Dr. Shailesh Kumar Agarwal sir for keenly being participating sir, from starting to end, and also having a very heated discussions towards our webinar. So I thank you both for giving this opportunity to us, and we will be going towards taking these points and organizing more self-awareness campaigns towards this. I thank all the three speakers of today's webinar, starting with Ashish Sharma sir, SK Negi sir, and Ajay Chaurasia sir. Thank you for always giving us all the information, all the experiences you have for all these years you have been in the service. And I hope that we, as through our program, we said that rural housing needs more attention, and hopefully the participants will learn and accept that self-reliance is very important in going toward disaster safe housing. I thank you, the convener of this program, Amir Ali Khan sir, for giving the participants this opportunity to hear about this topic and also bringing out the key questions that needed to be heard from our speakers. I thank in the end all the participants for joining with us, for bearing all the patience, and we are flooded with many, many questions, and I hope through our discussions as well, we have covered all your questions. We have a very good feedback as well. So I thank each and everyone for showing your interest, and with this, I'd like to conclude and close the session for today.
So I also join Yogita, number one, thanking Yogita herself for nicely coordinating the thing. So thank you so much, Yogita, for everything. You nicely coordinated the thing. And our patrons, Shailesh ji, and our Executive Director, Manoj Kumar Bindal sahab, for guiding us through this webinar. Shailesh ji for making wonderful presentation, keynote address, and closing remarks. Negi sahab, aapka to hamesha se number one hota hai presentation, no doubt. So nice pictures. Sharma ji, aap hamesha to the point hote hain. कोई चीज होता नहीं है. चौरसिया साहब, आपके तो मैंने पिछली बार भी बोला था, आपके जो स्लाइड्स थे ना, वो मुंह में पानी आता है उनको देख के. सो आप जल्दी से उस किताब को रिलीज करवाइए, एंड सो दैट वी कैन शेयर ऑल दीज थिंग्स एट नेशनल लेवल विद द पार्टिसिपेंट्स. सो थैंक यू ऑल फॉर नाइसली पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन दिस, एनलाइटनिंग ऑल ऑफ अस. एंड लास्ट बट नॉट द लीस्ट, थैंक यू टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स फॉर स्पेयरिंग दैट मच ऑफ टाइम. सो विद दिस वी जस्ट गो फॉर क्लोजिंग. So thank you once again for everything. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.